Hello and welcome to SPMIS Daily Newspaper Analysis. In today's session, we will be taking up important issues of 26th August 2019. The target of this program is to discuss important issues from UPSC Civil Services exam point of view. The first article of the day is about conservation of Western Ghats. This came on page 11 of the Hindu, Delhi edition. It is relevant to the syllabus from GS paper 3, Environment and Biodiversity. Context: the article has been written by Madhav Gadgil. He is an environmentalist and was chairman of Western Ghat Ecological Expert Group. Western Ghat. So Western Ghat is a series of linear mountain extending from Gujarat to Kerala. And for the conservation of Western Ghats, Western Ghat Ecological Expert Group was set up under chairmanship of Madhav Gadgil in 2010. Let us see the recommendations of the panel. So, on the basis of slope, elevation and natural vegetation, the committee recommended that 60% of the Western Ghats should be declared as ecologically sensitive zone under Environment Protection Act 1986. So, jahan pe slope jada steep hoga, jahan pe height ya elevation jada hogi and natural vegetation jada dense honge, waise areas ko demarcate kiya is panel ne aur lagbhag ऐसे 60% एरियाज को डिमार्केट करके बोला कि इनको डिक्लेयर कर देना चाहिए इकोलॉजिकली सेंसिटिव जोन अंडर एनवायरनमेंट प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट 1986 एंड आफ्टर डिक्लेयरिंग इट एज इकोलॉजिकली सेंसिटिव जोन एक्टिविटीज लाइक माइनिंग क्वेरिंग शुड बी कंप्लीटली प्रोहिबिटेड इन सच एरियाज एंड इन रिमेनिंग 40% लैंड ऑफ वेस्टर्न घाट द इंडस्ट्रियल एक्टिविटीज शुड बी अलाउड only after approval of local panchayat. But Madhav Gadgil committee's recommendations were not implemented. The state governments of Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala requested that if industrial activities will be completely stopped in Western Ghats, there will be hamper on economic growth of the states. And thus the committee chaired by K. Kasturi Ranjan was set up in 2014. A high-level working group chaired by K. Kasturi Ranjan was set up in 2014. The objective of this panel was to set up a balance between environment and economy. तो एनवायरनमेंट को कंजर्व करने के चक्कर में इकोनॉमी को पूरी तरह से सैक्रिफाइस ना कर दिया जाए इस तरह के ऑब्जेक्टिव को देखते हुए हमने के कस्तूरी रंजन कमेटी सरकार ने बनाई एज इट वाज फेल्ट लाइक माधव गाडगिल कमेटी इज टू मच लीडिंग टू एम्फेसिस ऑन एनवायरनमेंट व्हाइल नेग्लेक्टिंग इकोनॉमिक्स लेट अस सी द रिकमेंडेशंस ऑफ के कस्तूरी रंजन पैनल There is a need to balance environment and economics, so it recommended that only 37% land of the Western Ghats should be declared as ecologically sensitive zones. And in ecologically sensitive zones, industrial activities can be allowed but in a sustainable manner. So we can see there is a vast difference between the recommendation of Madhav Gadgil committee and K. Kasturi Ranjan committee. On one hand, Madhav Gadgil committee has completely banned any sort of industrial activity on 60% land of Western Ghat, while K. Kasturi Ranjan committee has led to restriction on only about 37% land of Western Ghat regarding industrial activities and that too industrial activities in such areas were allowed but in sustainable manner. So it is clear that Kasturi Ranjan panel proposed a very relaxed norms as compared to Madhav Gadgil committee and some of the recommendations of the K. Kasturi Ranjan committee was implemented. Now this particular article that we are reading right now is written by Madhav Gadgil and now he is arguing that the relaxed norms of the conservation of Western Ghat has led to activities like deforestation, mining and quarrying. and that has led to frequent floods, landslides and cloud burst in Kerala in two consecutive years in 2018 as well as 2019. तो दो साल लगातार से केरला में फ्लड आ रहा है, लैंडस्लाइड्स आ रहे हैं और उसका एक इम्पॉर्टेंट कारण अकॉर्डिंग टू माधव गाडगिल इज द पुअर इम्प्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ द इकोलॉजिकल नॉर्म्स इन वेस्टर्न घाट्स. तो जब एक बार फॉरेस्ट को क्लियर कर दिया जाता है फ्रॉम द हिली एरियाज एंड व्हेन इट गेट डीन्यूडेड, तो जो ऊपरी लैंड होता है वो धीरे धीरे लूज हो जाता है बिकॉज ऑफ एक्टिविटीज लाइक माइनिंग एंड क्वेरिंग. तो ये जो ऊपर का सरफेस जब लूज हो जाता है, देन बारिश के सीजन में व्हेन देयर इज ह्यूज रेनफॉल, स्पेशली इन वेस्टर्न घाट्स हमें पता है कि बहुत ज़्यादा बारिश होती है, तो जब बहुत ज़्यादा बारिश होती है इन द मानसून सीजन, तो ये एक अपर लेयर ऑफ द लैंड गेट्स इरोडेड एंड स्टार्ट्स टू फ्लो अलॉन्ग विद द वाटर, जिसको हम लोग लैंड स्लाइड बोलते हैं. और ये लैंड स्लाइड जब हैवी अमाउंट में होता है तो नीचे के गांव में आकर के इट कॉजेस ह्यूज डिस्ट्रक्शंस टू लाइफ एंड प्रॉपर्टी, जो केरला में हम लोग पिछले दो सालों से लगातार देख रहे हैं. एंड अकॉर्डिंग टू माधव गाडगिल कमिटी द मेन रीजन बिहाइंड सच फ्रीक्वेंट लैंड स्लाइड्स एंड फ्लड इज द पुअर इम्प्लीमेंटेशन ऑफ इकोलॉजिकल नॉर्म्स इन वेस्टर्न घाट्स. सो सम ऑफ द सजेशंस हैव बीन मेड बाय माधव गाडगिल. ही सेड दैट देर इज नीड टू प्रमोट पार्टिसिपेशन ऑफ पीपल एट द लोकल लेवल फॉर कंजर्वेशन पर्पज, बिकॉज लोकल पीपल नो वॉट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर कंजर्वेशन ऑफ द इको सिस्टम इन द सराउंडिंग एरियाज. He says that incentivizing the conservation of environment by giving some charges to the communities engaged in conservation. तो इनका कहना है कि सिर्फ norms बनाने से या law बनाने से ecological conservation नहीं होगा, जो भी communities ecological conservation, ecosystem conservation में लगी हैं उनको कुछ service charge देना चाहिए, उनको कुछ पैसे का अगर incentive दिया जाएगा then there will be better conservation of ecosystems. Let us have a practice question on the basis of this topic. Which of the following statements are true? The elevation of western ghats increases as one moves from south to north. Western ghats is known as Nilgiris in Maharashtra. You can post your answer in the comment section. The next article is about children in mining and they are skipping their schools. The article came on page 9 of the Hindu. It is relevant to the syllabus from GS paper 2 governance, issues related to poverty and hunger. Context: The National Commission on Protection of Child Rights (NCPCR) found that mica mines in Bihar and Jharkhand employs more than 5000 children. What is the news? The National Commission on Protection of Child Rights has found that more than 5000 children in the age group of 6 to 14 years are engaged in mining activities in mica mines of Bihar and Jharkhand. Many such children are the main source of earning for their family. तो ये जो बच्चे काम कर रहे हैं माइंस में, वो अपने फैमिली को इकोनॉमिकली सस्टेन करने का एक अकेला सोर्स है इन मोस्ट ऑफ देयर फैमिलीज. बच्चों को एम्प्लॉयमेंट ज़्यादातर माइनिंग एक्टिविटीज़ में इसलिए मिल जाती है बिकॉज उनको लंबे समय तक काम कराया जा सकता है इन रिटर्न ऑफ लेसर वेजेज. द चिल्ड्रेन हु हैव बीन एंगेज इन माइनिंग एक्टिविटीज हैव अबैंडन्ड एजुकेशन प्रोवाइडेड अंडर राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट 2019. सो we have seen in our basic polity class as well that a right to education under article 21 is a fundamental right, and according to the right to education act 2009 each and every children between age group of 6 to 14 year should compulsorily get primary education, but these children are skipping schools and getting involved in mining activities, so this is breach of one of the fundamental rights as well. Another law, Child Rights Protection and Regulation Act 2016, prohibits employment of children between age group of 6 to 14 years. It prohibits employment of children of age group 14 to 18 years in hazardous industries. Now, the article says that regulations like Right to Education and Child Rights Act have failed to yield results due to poverty. And the article itself says that child labor is a social and economic reality in India. And to curb it, the government must promote employment opportunity for the people with low skill sets. जब तक बहुत हाई लेवल की पॉवर्टी रहेगी हमारे कंट्री में until and unless people with low skill set gets appropriate opportunities to work, they will keep on engaging their children in some sort of laborious activities. और तब तक हमारे देश में चाइल्ड लेबर की प्रॉब्लम दूर नहीं होगी डिस्पाइट लॉज लाइक राइट टू एजुकेशन एंड चाइल्ड राइट्स एक्ट. तो हमें एक हद तक लो स्किल सेट वाले लोगों के लिए एम्प्लॉयमेंट अपॉर्चुनिटी जनरेट करना होगा, तभी जा कर के चाइल्ड लेबर का प्रॉब्लम इंडिया में सॉल्व हो पाएगा. एंड वी नीड टू अप्रिसिएट दैट चाइल्ड लेबर इज कैन नॉट बी रिजॉल्व ओनली थ्रू लॉज एंड रेगुलेशंस, इट इज अ सोशल एंड इकोनॉमिक रियालिटी ऑफ इंडिया. Let us have a practice question. Which of the following state in India has highest reserve of mica? Options Bihar, Jharkhand, Andhra Pradesh and Karnataka. You can post your answer in the comment section. Next article is about panel for bank fraud. It came on page 12 of the Hindu. It is relevant to the syllabus from GS paper 2 governance. The Central Vigilance Commission has set up a panel to probe bank fraud. So let us see what is the news. Central Vigilance Commission has established an advisory board for banking frauds. The mandate of the advisory board for bank frauds are that it will investigate the bank frauds of rupees 50 crores or above. It has been established by Central Vigilance Commission, but it will function in consultation with RBI. The board will have a chairman and three members. The chairman should be a retired vigilance commissioner. The term of every member will be limited to 2 years. Let us have some understanding about Central Vigilance Commission. It is a statutory body under CVC Act of 2003. It was established in 1964 to prevent corruption in public offices. It acts as an autonomous body and reports directly to the parliament. Mind it, in 1964, Central Vigilance Commission was established on recommendation of Santhanam Committee that was established for prevention of corruption in public offices. At that time, it was established as a result of an executive order, but in 2003, a law was passed by the parliament, CVC Act, and after it became a statutory body. Let us have a practice question. Which of the following statements are true about Central Vigilance Commission? It has been established on recommendation of Santhanam Committee on Prevention of Corruption. It investigates the offenses mentioned in the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988. You can post your answer in the comment sections. Let us see the answers of the practice question given in the last lecture. Which of the following statements are true? Cess is an additional tax on income over a certain limit, while surcharge is tax on tax for a specific purpose. Well, FDI is more stable and FPI is volatile. So in the last session also we had discussed that a cess is imposed by central government, is a tax on tax levied by the government for a specific purpose. For example, a higher education cess, Krishi Kalyan cess. तो कृषि कल्याण सेस लगाया जाएगा फॉर इम्प्रूवमेंट इन एग्रीकल्चर सेक्टर, वाइल हायर एजुकेशन सेस लगाया जाएगा फॉर हायर एजुकेशन. तो इसको एक स्पेसिफिक पर्पस से लगाया जाता है. वाइल सरचार्ज इज टैक्स ऑन टैक्स दैट हैज बीन ऑलरेडी पेड एंड इट इज नॉट फॉर अ स्पेसिफिक पर्पस. सो द फर्स्ट स्टेटमेंट इज रॉन्ग. FDI इज मोर स्टेबल वाइल FPI इज वोलेटाइल. सो इन द लास्ट lecture itself we had seen difference between FDI and FPI. FPI is the investment through the stock market, while FDI is the real capital investment. So of course FDI is more stable because withdrawal of FDI is difficult. अगर जिस कंपनी ने एक बार इंडिया में आ करके इंडस्ट्री सेटअप कर दिया है उसका फिर इंडिया से जल्दी विड्रॉ करना मुश्किल है. लेकिन जिसने भी स्टॉक मार्केट में पैसा लगाया है वो जब चाहे तब स्टॉक मार्केट से विड्रॉ कर सकता है. सो दिस स्टेटमेंट इज करेक्ट एंड द करेक्ट आंसर विल बी टू ओनली. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन, विच आर द फॉलोइंग स्टेटमेंट्स आर ट्रू अबाउट FATF. Its main objective is to curb terror financing and prevent money laundering. This statement is true. We had seen in the last lecture itself. It has 39 member countries, including India and Pakistan. This statement is wrong in two ways. In the last lecture itself, we had seen that it has 37 member countries plus two organizations, European Council and GCC. And apart from it, you also must know that Pakistan is not a member of FATF, but India is a member of FATF. So the correct answer will be A, one only. Next question, which of the following country is not a member of GCC? So GCC is a political and economic alliance of six countries in the Arabian Peninsula. These countries are Bahrain, Kuwait, Oman, Qatar, Saudi Arabia and United Arab Emirates. So the correct answer will be D. Iran is not a member of GCC. Which of the following is not part of reasonable restriction on freedom of speech and expression under Article 19.2? So I have rephrased this question because in the last slide I had given the way the question was presented was not appropriate. So the new question is this. In the last slide itself, we had discussed the grounds for reasonable restriction on freedom of speech and expressions are sovereignty and integrity of India, security of the state, friendly relation with the foreign states, public order, decency or morality, contempt of court, defamation and incitement to an offense. So these are the grounds on which there can be a restriction put on freedom of speech and expression. So all these factors are there on which there can be a restriction on speech and expression. So the correct answer will be D, all of the above. Last question, which of the following is the largest island of the world? The correct answer will be Greenland. Though Australia is bigger than Greenland, but it is counted as a continent, not as an island. So the correct answer will be B, Greenland. That is for the day. Thank you.